episode, we'll be touring the Olbrich Gardens to take in the breathtaking fall colors. While on the tour, we'll visit the tropics right on the grounds. After our stroll, we'll end our day at the Daisy Café and Cupcakery for some tasty sweet treats.
Welcome to Slice of Life with Veronica Harper. Today we are touring the Olbrich Gardens, and it's a gorgeous day today, so it should be a good time.
As part of our tour today, we'll be stopping over to the Tropical Boltz Conservatory to sample the diverse collection of plants. We'll meander over to the Thai Pavilion and Garden, which was a royal gift from the country of Thailand and the University of Madison Thai alumni. We'll also check out several other gardens and see how Olbrich is staying eco-friendly. Our first stop of the day is the Boltz Conservatory.
Behind me is the Boltz Conservatory. It's supposed to be pretty tropical in there, so let's go check it out.
Inside, you can experience a tropical paradise all year round. The large glass pyramid is bursting with colorful plant life, vivid flowers, a cascading waterfall, sweetly scented orchids, and free-flying birds. This tropical haven hosts 650 plants with 475 different species and embodies more than 80 plant varieties. The plants you'll see here are naturally found in subtropical regions throughout the world. During hot summer days, temperatures could reach 95 degrees. However, in chilly Wisconsin winters, the conservatory is a welcome change of temperature. It's pleasantly kept between 65 and 80 degrees Fahrenheit. The conservatory is open year-round, and you can either do a self-guided tour or schedule a tour with a guide. We wanted to get all the insider tips, so we tagged along with one of the expert garden tour guides.
And you can see that there are cherries on it. We call them cherries because inside them are the beans.
Oh, the actual beans are in there?
So every cherry has two beans.
Okay.
And that's what's harvested, so it'll change from green to red to dark, and that's when they're ready to be harvested.
So do you actually harvest them?
No.
Okay.
No. Probably pick up some of them that do drop to the ground when they are ripe. So it's not like I can say in 3 weeks, oh, they're going to be red at all.
It's not like a particular season or anything?
No, I've seen them at different times, and you're in a controlled environment as well.
Right.
So it's not like the natural world where mm-hmm. you would find them.
I've never been actually this close to a coffee tree before. I had no idea.
So you love coffee?
I do. I do love coffee.
You know, it's economically second only to oil in terms of money.
Is that right?
Second only to oil.
I did not know that. And
we're going to go buy that coffee tree. It's a nice big coffee tree.
Oh, it, yeah. It's.
You know, if we let them grow to what they're meant to be.
Oh, I see red ones up there. Yep.
Probably the
I
red
do.
Ones up on top. It'll happen sooner because they are higher up.
Yep.
With the exposure to more light.
And
look
they just
at how thick they can get.
Can we touch this?
Not allowed
typically
to touch.
No,
but
no.
I'll let you.
Okay.
Typically
it's
no.
But. Very smooth.
Mm-hmm.
So they just drop and you just let...
Well, if it's a harvest situation, when they're ripe, they'll go through and they won't wait for them to drop to the ground. I suspect the breast growers don't use machinery for them.
Probably not. Just hand pick.
Yeah, and that's where you've got your shade-grown coffee, that the forest trees are not taken down in order to have the trees. Also, the fair trade, where the workers actually get to benefit and those who grow get to benefit from the product.
I'll be honest, I don't know too much about coffee and the behind the scenes, but
you're
I love
not a coffee drinker.
I love drinking it, but
no,
let's go make our way over to the cacao trees.
We can do that. We're going to go by way of one that is down on this level, and then we'll make it up to the other one and see if there's any pods.
How many total cacao trees do you have?
Two that I'm aware of. One is actually planted, the other is in a pot.
So we're at the cacao tree now.
Well, here's the cacao tree.
My favorite. I love chocolate.
Yes, and you're one of millions
of people,
more people
right?
who love it.
Mm-hmm.
So these have potential for being a pod.
So are these little flowers that we see, do these
Those
turn
could,
into pods?
They could. Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, they have the pollinator.
Okay.
And this, you know, the spelling is different. It was mispronounced as cocoa, but it's actually cacao, and it is where our chocolate comes from.
And what happens with the actual pods?
We don't harvest them. We even have a sign up there because people were taking them. So they can be, when they drop, they'll be picked up, but we don't do anything with them that I'm aware of because we don't have that many.
Mm-hmm.
The cocoa bean itself is actually very bitter.
Mm-hmm. Too bitter.
It tastes too bitter.
Yeah.
And so it's what we do to it that brings out the chocolate flavor and, of course, the sweet flavor.
You gotta add the sugar,
yes.
You gotta add the
yes.
milk,
yes.
the heavy cream.
And it's a big money maker.
Right. Well, let's go check up the one upstairs. What is this tree? Oh my goodness,
that's
this is
the cacao.
These are huge.
So these are probably almost beyond ripe, but that gives you the idea of the size of them.
And they just fall
They'll
to the ground.
Mm-hmm. But I expect that where they grow them as a to harvest, they'll pick them when they're ripe. Look at how well it grows. It's in a pot.
Oh yeah.
So chocolate, yeah.
All that chocolate. Just waiting to be eaten.
Uh-huh.
That's tea?
I think that's what it said.
It's an actual tea plant,
mm-hmm.
which I have never seen.
I can't tell you anything about that because...
I wonder, does it smell like the flowers? No, there isn't.
No.
So it must occur after they harvest.
Star fruit. Have you ever heard of star fruit?
Yes, I have. This is a star fruit tree.
Yeah. So the official name is down there. But you can see there's some of the fruit growing right there. Orchids, those are interchanged periodically as we have some that are blossoming.
Mm-hmm.
And then they'll grow up around out and others be put back. And orchids are pretty amazing because there are so many different kinds. Some have scents, some don't. And all unique and beautiful.
So there's all kinds of birds I've noticed while we've been here that are whipping around. They almost ran into me a couple of times. So how many different species of birds
do we have?
Well,
we have canaries, we have blackbills, diamond doves, smaller than your doves like the morning doves that you see.
I think I saw one downstairs. They were scuttering around
up on the
floor, on the ground. Right?
We have a number of species of the quail. I can't believe this. You won't see it. I just saw a butterfly.
Oh.
From our butterfly exhibit.
Right, but you have the exhibit.
That we had in the summer, we had blooming butterflies.
Right.
I think we were in our 11th or 12th year of having it. So this
it
is one
survived.
Of longevity. And as long as there's flowers, yep, there.
Yeah, there it is.
That's a zebra. I am totally amazed. That it is still alive. I thought when I was here several weeks ago that was the end of that. Nope.
Still okay. Sticking around.
Here's a pod, right?
In the summertime, more than 12 species of butterflies are on display during the Blooming Butterflies annual exhibit. Some of the species are native to Wisconsin, while others are found in the southern United States. You'll be able to experience live butterflies emerging every day. Some of the butterflies get to be amazingly large. Although it is advised not to touch the butterflies, a good way to make sure some land on you is to wear brightly colored clothing.
Okay, we got, this is the actual exhibit of our carnivorous plants.
This is it.
A number of plants in the conservatory don't just feed off sunlight, but insect life as well.
Did you notice that there was out in front when you came in, a terrarium?
There was a small terrarium.
The carnivorous plants in the conservatory include Venus flytraps, pitcher plants, butterworts, sundews, and sun pitchers.
It probably has a purple pitcher plant in there. It has good examples of
the Venus flytrap, right?
And sundew.
Okay.
And they all are different in how they bring
insects in.
The insects in.
Well, there's a white liquid that the plants release.
Yes.
These plants ooze a translucent liquid that is irresistible to insects and makes it unable for them to escape.
It draws the insects in.
The unsuspecting insects have no idea that this will be the last plant they ever visit.
And once they're in, they're trapped, and it can't come out.
Is it? It must be sticky.
Well,
it's not just the shape.
It was that the fine hairs that are in there are going downward.
Okay.
And
I can kind of see them.
Resistant, mm-hmm. And so it's not unusual for pitcher plants to collect water inside those. So if the insect drops down, let's say from exhaustion, it drowns.
Mm-hmm.
That's when the pitcher plant takes over and begins to absorb the nutrients of the body. I remember once seeing one of these that had died, and they opened it up and had it at our exploration station downstairs, and there were insect parts in the bottom.
Left over?
Mm-hmm. It doesn't eat the body, it absorbs the nutrients. So that's why it's not actually
carnivorous,
like the movie show.
Right.
And we know with the Venus flytrap, it closes very quickly, captures the insect inside, goes through the same process of absorbing the nutrients from the body.
And you leave these lights on 24 hours?
Yes. We do have animals in here that are active at night, like frogs.
Mm-hmm. There he is. Yep.
He's
right there, just hanging out. Yep.
Uh-huh.
See him? There's two of them. There's another one on the other side.
Right. So, but those are the ones we don't typically see.
He's happy up there.
So a nice mix of plants in here that you certainly come away with feeling like you've had a visit to the rainforest.
So here we're standing in front of this beautiful waterfall.
Mm-hmm.
And this water goes all the way, it's connected to the one at the bottom?
Yes, so it goes down underneath, comes out over here, flows down over what was like a waterfall into the water below.
We'll head out to smell the roses and stroll through the specialty outdoor gardens featuring spectacular landscapes and Midwest plants. The native stone Outlook Tower offers picturesque views of the gardens and Lake Monona. The Midwest's finest collection of roses are featured in the Rose Garden. The landscape is speckled with colorful perennials, swaying decorative grasses, blossoming bushes, vines, and small ornate trees, as well as vibrant spring bulbs.
And now let's head over to the Thai Pavilion, where we can experience a bit of Eastern culture right here in Madison.
The Thai Thai government and the Thai chapter of the Wisconsin Alumni Association gave this pavilion as a gift to the University of Wisconsin-Madison and was opened to the public on June 15, 2002. The Thai Pavilion stands 30 feet high and 40 feet long, with an estimated worth between $1.5 to $2 million. The wooden pavilion exhibits a lacquer finish and complex embellishments.
The lotus represents purity and is often depicted in Eastern religions with different gods and goddesses.
The gold leaf etchings, special preparation, and rarity are what makes this pavilion so special to Olbrich.
The Thai Pavilion was constructed over several weeks, and there are absolutely no nails or screws or glue of any kind in the construction. Be sure not to touch anything when you come and visit, because the oils in your hand can destroy the gold leaf.
This pavilion is traditionally known as Salawan Khan, and it bears the royal crest of Thailand. This means it was sanctioned by the royal family of Thailand along with the Thai national government.
We're standing in front of the Thai Pavilion, or Sala, and in front of the pavilion are three pools of water, and these pools of water represent peace and serenity.
A customary Thai-style garden with tranquil reflecting pools surround the open-air pavilion. The pools surrounding the Thai Pavilion are there to help in meditation. Water in Buddhist tradition cultivates purity and calmness. The ponds help with the serenity of a person's atmosphere. It is only one of four such pavilions in the world located outside of Thailand, and the only one surrounded by a garden. The cast iron elephant was given to the gardens as a gift from the Princess of Thailand. The elephant is a prevalent symbol in Thailand and is associated with royalty.
The sunken garden is a traditional English-style garden with limestone terraces.
The sunken garden offers a formal English-style garden. An 80-foot reflecting pool is the main attraction in the garden, which gets its name because of the 2-foot drop around the edges of the landscape. It would be a perfect setting for a Jane Austen novel. Terraces surrounding the sunken garden were carved out of regional Wisconsin limestone.
This is Olbrich's oldest garden, having changed from a perennial garden to the sunken garden in 1952.
This attractive lawn is open year-round, but is a must-see from spring through early autumn. As a private partner collaboration, the Olbrich Gardens also have a supply of honeybees. In order to collect the honey, they use pine needles as a non-toxic resource. The needles are lit up and then dried out. The bees are tricked into thinking there's a fire because of the smoke. This prevents them from stinging the bee collectors, which allows them to go in and harvest the honey. What a great way to be kind to the environment! Any extra honey that the bees don't need during the winter months is collected and sold as a benefit to Olbrich. Olbrich is using some eco-friendly ways to help improve the environment. Their latest addition, the electric tram, was introduced to help visitors who may have trouble walking the 16 acres of beautiful landscape. The tram is completely electric and adds to the green theme that is used to run the gardens. While riding the tram in a circular pattern, passengers can enjoy listening to the history, plant care, and upcoming events.
We hope you had a good visit here at the Olbrich Gardens, and we're here at the Rose Garden. The Rose Garden is a very popular spot to hold weddings. Right behind me is the Rose Garden Tower, and it stands about 40 feet tall. It has a beautiful view of the 2 acres as well as the lake behind us. Until next time, I'm Veronica Harper. Keep on exploring.
Next, we'll enjoy some sweet treats at the Daisy Café and Cupcakery. After walking all day, we've built up quite an appetite. Heading northwest of the Olbrich Gardens, just a hop, skip, and a jump away is the Daisy Café and Cupcakery. We decided to stop by to get a sweet bite to eat, but more importantly, to find out, what is a cupcakery anyway?
We're here at the Daisy Café and Cupcakery in Madison. It's a pretty popular spot for breakfast, lunch, and dinner, but we're here for the cupcakes. Let's go in.
Every day, 20 cupcake varieties are made, including vegan and gluten-free. The classic line includes America's favorite, like the red velvet, and other popular ones, like the champagne cupcake, made with fresh fruit and strawberry frosting. If you're a chocoholic like me, a more deluxe cupcake might be right up your alley. My favorite is the extremely chocolate cupcake. It includes chocolate cake with chocolate buttercream filling and chocolate ganache frosting. So rich, yet tastes so good. There are certainly lots to choose from, as the themes are changed every month with different flavors. We met up with owner Daryl Sisson for a lowdown on the cupcakery.
We're here with Daryl Sisson, owner of the Daisy Café and Cupcakery. Hi Daryl, how are you doing?
Okay, thanks.
Good. So tell us a little bit about your restaurant here.
Well, we're a full service, casual restaurant. We've got breakfast and lunch served every day and dinners Tuesdays through Saturdays. And of course, we sell an awful lot of cupcakes. We're Wisconsin's first gourmet cupcakery.
What made you decide on the word cupcakery?
Oh, cupcakery. Well, I was an English major, so I love to play with words. And for me, it was just an easy, smart kind of way to shorten cupcake bakery. Put it together, it's a cupcakery.
Well, it certainly sticks to you, right? It does.
People
remember that, right? What cupcake do people come in to order the most?
Well, America's favorite cupcake is a red velvet cupcake. But I think where we really established ourselves is we do a monthly theme on deluxe cupcakes, and they are seasonal, they're fun.
So tell us, what qualifies for the four C's of Daisy Café and Cupcakery?
Oh yes,
what's included?
We are a cafe, we are a cupcakery, we sell coffee, and we're all about community.
The cupcakes here are delicious.
Maybe we can teach you how to make a cupcake.
I am up for that. Let's do it.
Fabulous. This is actually our prep area, but we're walking into our bakery. I'm happy to introduce you to one of our top bakers, Audrey.
Hi, Audrey.
Hi.
Nice to meet you. So, what are we going to do today?
So, we are going to do the vanilla raspberry cupcake.
Okay.
So, this is our classic cupcake. It's just a vanilla cake. We make everything handmade and fresh ingredients and everything. So what we're going to do is, here's your piping bag.
All right.
What you're going to do is kind of fold it down like this. Hey, you got it.
Well, you know what? I did take some cake baking classes.
There
I have to admit.
Okay,
and
so you got this.
We'll see.
Okay, and there's your tip. We're going to put that.
Okay.
Perfect.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
I know what I'm doing.
Yeah, she's got this.
Kinda. I'm no expert like you, but we'll see.
All right.
Okay.
So we're going to get our buttercream in here.
Okay.
We'll push it down so we don't have any bubbles.
Mm-hmm.
Just need a little bit. Do you want to do yourself?
Yep.
All right, there you go.
Okay, just a little bit then?
A little more than that.
A little more.
Yeah.
We love buttercream.
Uh-huh.
Who doesn't, right? Okay.
Excellent. Okay.
So.
Yeah, so you're going to push it all the way down.
Yep.
There you go. Kind of, get your tip.
There it is.
Uh-huh. And then you want to give your bag a little twist.
Okay. Uh-huh. Twist in the bag.
Perfect. And then I like to wrap it around my finger like that. Get a little stability.
And then there we go.
Yeah, there you go.
That's right.
Okay. So we're just gonna do a classic a spiral. We do three times around.
Okay.
You just wanna give it a little bit of pressure to see how it feels. Now fall your way up and then end with a little.
Nice. All right.
Yeah, perfect.
Check it out here. So we start in the middle?
We start a little bit to the side.
Okay.
Yeah, perfect. There you go. Keep pushing. Nice!
Woo!
Yeah!
It's a little flatter.
Oh,
yours
is
more like a Christmas tree.
You did very well.
Okay, awesome.
So then we top all our cupcakes with fresh fruit.
Okay.
We have some raspberries here. We're just going to pop this on top.
Okay.
There you go.
And there you go.
And that's our classic.
Finished product. And now do we get to eat it? The best part, right?
Go for it.
All right.
Should I go too?
Yeah, absolutely. Cheers. To Daisy Café.
Yeah.
I'm gonna just bite right into it. Oh my god, this is really good.
Mm-hmm. Very crazy.
Audrey, I hear there's a certain way that you're supposed to eat a cupcake.
You can eat a cupcake however you want.
All right, this is the way I eat
but
it.
This is, yeah, exactly. That's how we get it. Cool. But there's kind of a neater way.
Okay.
And then you're kind of trying to twist the top off a little bit.
Oh.
It kind of comes off.
There you go. Kind of broken. I'm only screwing this up.
Okay, and then real quick, we're going to flip it over like that.
Like
that way.
Cool.
Perfect. Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah.
And so it's a cupcake sandwich.
Uh-huh. And then you can. There you go. Thank you.
Very good.
Now that we discovered what the Daisy Café and Cupcakery is, we'll definitely be back for more to satiate our sweet tooth craving with some delectable baked goods. I give it 5 out of 5 cupcakes. Whether you're in the area or not, I hope you end up here. It's definitely a Daisy do. You never know what kind of cupcake you might find.